the pulmonary blood supply in each child will be very different based on the number of MAPKAs and the type of the MAPKAs and the pulmonary arteries. So the strategy of approach to treatment also will differ. So this constitutes 1.4% of all the congenital heart defects, and many of them are associated with 22q11 deletion. A few may be associated with VACTERL charge or Allegheny syndrome. If they have a right arch or an aberrant subclavian artery, or if they have a very complex anatomy like very hypoplastic PAs or very complex MAPKAs, they are more likely to be associated with 22q11 deletion. Basically, this is classified into three types. This is called as the Barbaro-Marshall classification, type A, B, and C, based on what is the pulmonary blood supply. So in type A, the sole supply to the pulmonary arteries is by the patent ductus arteriosus. So there are no iatropulmonary collaterals in this type. Since in this type, usually the branch pulmonary arteries are good sized, and the long-term prognosis in this type will be good. But the early attrition will be high because the PDA is a precarious supply. It can close any time. So in the newborn period, they can present with acidosis or shock or extreme cyanosis when this PDA is closing. But once you intervene early, the long-term prognosis will be better because they don't require multiple stages. Early you can do a complete repair, and only for the conduit replacements, they will require redo surgeries. But in type B and type C, there are iatropulmonary collaterals. In type B, there are native pulmonary arteries also, and collateral arteries also. The native pulmonary arteries are often hypoplastic in this type, unlike the type A. In type C, it is only iatropulmonary collaterals. There are no native central pulmonary arteries. In these two types, that is type B and C, the early attrition is less. Like the collaterals are more stable source of supply. They don't suddenly close off, so they don't die in the newborn period, or they don't present in a shock or acidosis. But in the long run, they develop stenosis, progressive stenosis of these collaterals, and even the surgical strategy is difficult in them. So the long-term prognosis is little poorer as compared to type A. 60% of these infants, if you don't intervene, survive only up to 60% survive up to 1 year. And of these who survive up to 1 year, another 60% will live up to 10 years. And out of these, only 16% will live up to 35 years of age. If PDA is the sole supply of the blood, pulmonary blood flow, then the prognosis is even, the mortality is even more in the first 1 year. Only 10% will survive the first year if you don't intervene in the first year. So these this subgroup of patients can present in three different clinical presentations. The first group will be a moderate to severe stenosis, cyanosis, but they will not have any heart failure. This is because they will be having a stenosed PDA or stenosed collaterals. So the blood supply to the lungs are less, so they present with cyanosis. The other subgroup can be those who present with cardiac failure symptoms. This is where the pulmonary arteries or the PDA or the collaterals are large in size, and there are multiple collaterals that can result in cardiac failure symptoms. There is one more group who present with a balanced circulation. They will have only mild cyanosis, around 85 to 90% saturation. So the cyanosis is very mild, and they are not in cardiac failure. Here, the pulmonary blood flow is just adequate. But that doesn't mean that we can wait upon this subset. Though they have a balanced circulation, there can be some segments of the lung which are overperfused and some segments where there is less blood flow. So even the subset which present with less symptoms or balanced circulation features, we have to assess them early in their life, and we have to decide upon the strategy to intervene, when we have to intervene, based upon their pulmonary blood supply. So this is the first X-ray. That's the left-sided X-ray. Is usually the X-ray what we find in pulmonary atresia. So there is a RV type of apex. It's almost like a tetralogy X-ray. You have a concave pulmonary bay, a boot-shaped heart, and pulmonary oligemia. Most often they have 25 to 50% of these children can have a right aortic arch. So you can see a right aortic arch in this X-ray. But some of them can have a significant amount of collaterals. In such case, you can see this reticular type of pattern in the lungs. So this kind of an X-ray can also be seen in pulmonary atresia. So the ECG often shows right axis deviation and right ventricular hypertrophy, unlike the other group of pulmonary atresia, intact ventricular septum, where you find a left ventricular dominance. So echo, the basic diagnosis is always on the echo. The diagnosis of pulmonary atresia is first made on the echo. You have to get some more details to decide upon the surgery. So intracardiac wise, you have to know what is the orientation of the VST with respect to the aorta. So aorta can be overriding, or sometimes aorta can completely come from the right ventricle. The number of VST, whether there are any additional VSTs apart from the subaortic VST, whether there are native PAs or not, whether they are present, and if present, what is the size of the native PAs. That's a very crucial information you have to get from the echocardiogram. Then what are the source of blood supply to the lungs, to the native PAs, whether it is the PDA or whether there are collaterals. So you have to look for a vertical PDA in the suprasternal view. Most often it is a vertical PDA in pulmonary atresia. When they are disconnected branch pulmonary arteries, there can be bilateral ductuses. In such cases, you have to look for a PDA arising from the base of the innominate artery. So often they are associated with ascending aortic dilatation and aortic regurgitation. And you have to assess the arch-sidedness. That is helpful in the surgical strategy also. And it also gives you a clue that they can be associated with 22q11. If in right-sided arches, the association with 22q11 dilation is higher. And when there are large MAPKAs, the LV size can be dilated. And one of the most important thing you have to see is whether there is an interatrial communication or not. When you're going for an angiogram, cardiac catheterization, if you're not able to demonstrate the native PAs by other methods, you have to do a pulmonary venous wedge injection, for which you need an interatrial communication to enter the pulmonary vein. So it's better we delineate, we find out whether that is there or not on the echocardiogram itself. So cardiac catheterization has a very key role in assessment of pulmonary atresia VST. So in this, we can get a lot of information to make a decision about the timing of surgery, nature of surgery, and whether it's a staged or single stage. So cardiac catheterization is almost done in all the patients with pulmonary atresia VST. So the first information we want to get on cardiac catheterization is presence of native PAs, whether they are present or not. If they are present, what is the size of the native pulmonary arteries, and what is the distribution, like how is the peripheral abrasation of the native pulmonary arteries? So usually the native PAs are demonstrated by giving an injection through the PDA or through the collaterals selectively. Or if both these don't demonstrate, then we have to do a pulmonary venous wedge injection. After seeing the native pulmonary arteries, the next important thing we have to delineate is the number of iatropulmonary collaterals. So where is the origin, the size of the iatropulmonary collaterals? Whether stenosis is present. If it is present, is it proximal level stenosis, distal level or segmental level stenosis? And the course of the MAPKAs with respect to the carina, bronchus or esophagus, that is important for the surgeon. And how is the abrasation in the peripheral the segments of the lung, whether it's a communicating collateral or non-communicating collateral, meaning it's a sole supply to that lung segment, or is it a dual supply, both native PAs and the MAPKA are supplying that segment? And the pressure in the MAPKAs, especially the large MAPKAs, we need to know the pressure. And of course, the intracardiac part, we are going to see the number of VSDs, the aortic regurgitation, the ascending aorta size, and the coronaries. Quite often, it is challenging to optimize your contrast when you want to delineate so many things on the cardiac catheterization. So often, we try to get as much information on the echo, especially the intracardiac part, the VSD, AR, and other things, so that if you're short of contrast, you concentrate more on the iatropulmonary collaterals and the native pulmonary arteries rather than the intracardiac part. So here, this is an example where we are demonstrating the native PAs by giving an injection into the collateral. So this, we have entered a collateral which is from the descending aorta. So this is a communicating collateral. Sorry. This is a communicating collateral which is joining the left pulmonary artery at the hilum. And so that is demonstrating the native pulmonary artery. So you can see the size of the native pulmonary arteries, the abrasation of the native pulmonary arteries. This is a classical seagull appearance. This native pulmonary arteries is called as the seagull appearance, which is like a flying bird. The pulmonary arteries move with every cardiac contraction because it's an intrapericardial structure. So it moves with every cardiac contraction, and that gives the appearance like a flying bird. That's why it's called the seagull appearance. So this is a descending aortogram of a child where you can see that the native PAs are not seen, and there's only one small collateral which is also stenosed. Even on direct injection into this collateral, we could not demonstrate the native pulmonary arteries. So in such cases, you have to go and do a pulmonary venous wedge injection. So this is the pulmonary venous wedge injection. Here we can see that on the venous wedge, the pulmonary arterial confluence is demonstrated. So this is the pulmonary artery. You can demonstrate the peripheral abrasation of both the RPA and the LPA on the venous wedge injection here. Sometimes there need not be central pulmonary arteries, but there will be disconnected pulmonary arteries. They may be present only at the hilum. It is worth to demonstrate even that native pulmonary artery. So here we are giving injection into the one of the collaterals, and you can see that there is a retrograde filling of the pulmonary artery at the hilum. So this is a native pulmonary artery, but the central pulmonary arteries are atretic. Only at the hilum it is present, but even this can be recruited by putting a shunt onto the hilum. A BT shunt can be put onto the hilum of this, and we can help to recruit this pulmonary artery and rehabilitate this pulmonary artery as well. So we have to take every effort to demonstrate the native pulmonary arteries. Almost 80 to 85% of these kids will have native pulmonary arteries. We have to try various methods. If you give a non-specific injection only in the descending iatrogram, you may not be able to demonstrate pulmonary arteries in all these cases. So you have to give selective collateral injections or PDA injection or the pulmonary venous wedge to demonstrate this native pulmonary arteries. And we should take every effort to recruit these native pulmonary arteries. They have a great effort, the great potential to grow, especially if you recruit them in a younger age. So after demonstrating the native pulmonary arteries, it is next, it's the collaterals to be demonstrated. Rabinovich had classified these collaterals into three types. The first one is the bronchial artery collaterals, which arise from the bronchial artery, and the anastomosis with the pulmonary arteries is intrapulmonary. The second type is the direct aortic collaterals, which arise directly from the descending aorta, and at the hilum, it divides like a pulmonary artery and then supplies inside the lung. The third one is the indirect aortic collaterals, which are they arise from the branches of the aorta apart from the bronchial arteries. So it can be subclavian arteries, it can be internal memory, intercostal, vertebral, carotid, or it can be even coronary arteries. So these two are examples of bronchial collaterals. You can see that the anastomosis is intrapulmonary here. This is an example of a direct aortic collateral, where you can see that at the hilum, it enters the lung and divides like a pulmonary artery. Most often, the direct collaterals are very large. These are examples of indirect aortic collaterals. So this is a collateral arising from the base of the left carotid but supplying the right lung. This is a collateral from the right subclavian and supplying the right lung. Sometimes you can have collaterals from the coronary arteries. Unless you specifically look for it, sometimes you may miss them. So even on the echo, you have to look for any collaterals from the coronary arteries. Next, you have to look for stenosis in the collateral. So this is a descending iatrogram in a child where you can see that there are multiple collaterals, but almost all of them are stenosed at the origin. So this is a bad subset to start with. This is right in the infancy. These collaterals were stenosed. These two, if you see, there are stenosis, but the stenosis is limited to the proximal portion of the collateral. So here, if you see, the proximal part of the collateral is stenosed, but at the hilum, it is a very good sized collateral. So similarly here also, you can see that the proximal portion is stenosed, but distally at the hilum, the collateral is very good. So these kind of collaterals will still be able to use it for surgery. We can unifocalize at the hilum, so still we will be able to recruit these lung segments. But however, if the collaterals are like this, if there's a long segment stenosis and multiple level of stenosis within the collateral, then we'll not be able to recruit these collateral or this lung segment, especially if this collateral is a non-communicating collateral, then this segment of the lung cannot be recruited. It is a wasted segment of the lung. So that is precisely why we insist on early intervention in pulmonary atresias. So if we intervene early, before 6 months of age, we can prevent the progressive stenosis of these collaterals. As long as these collaterals are connected to the aorta, that is, when they are exposed to the systemic pressure, these stenosis is likely to progress. But once you incorporate them into the pulmonary arterial tree and the pressure is low, then the stenosis don't develop or they don't progress further at least. So in order to recruit maximum number of lung segments, you have to do the unifocalization surgery before the stenosis or PVOD develops. That is precisely why we have to evaluate early also. So next would be, we have to define the course of the collateral. So ideally, it would be ideal to have a biplane cath lab so that in one shot we can see two right angle views of the angiogram, so that we know the course of the marcus. But most often we don't have a biplane. In such cases, we can do a lateral angiogram also, at least for those collaterals where we suspect that it is a very tortuous course, and we suspect that this, the very course of this collateral, we know it is we want to know whether it is coursing over the bronchus, is it anterior or posterior to the carina and all. So we do a lateral angiogram to find out its relation to the airway, and that is necessary for the surgical planning. Similarly, this collateral from the right subclavian, we have given a lateral injection to see its relation to the trachea. So next, we have to demonstrate what is the arborization to the lung segment. So we have to clearly find out which areas of the lung are supplied by the native PA, which areas of the lung are supplied by the each MAPCA. So that will help in planning the surgical strategy. So if you see in this, this child had a, sorry for that. This child had undergone a central iatropulmonary shunt. This child had undergone a central iatropulmonary shunt for a hypoplastic native PAs. Here you can see the arborization of the LPA. The LPA is supplying the upper lobe and only a part of the lower lobe. The remaining part of the lower lobe is not arborized by the native PA. So there is another collateral from the descending aorta which is supplying that part of the lung. So we know that this to recruit this lung segment, we have to unifocalize this MAPCA. So because native PA doesn't have an arborization to that part of the lung. Similarly, this angiogram shows multiple collaterals from the aorta. So if you see the right lung itself, there are various collaterals which are supplying the right lung. So one from the subclavian is supplying a part of the lower lobe, a part of the upper lobe. One from the opposite carotid is supplying the medial segment of the lower lobe. And the middle lobe is supplied by another collateral from the descending aorta. So if you clearly demonstrate which segments are supplied by corresponding collaterals, we know that we have to unifocalize all these three if you have to recruit the entire right lung. So this is to demonstrate whether it's a communicating or non-communicating collateral. So this collateral we have entered deep into the collateral, and we can see that this collateral is joining the hilum, joining the lower lobe branch of the RPA at the hilum. So we can even enter through it and give an injection in the pulmonary artery. So this collateral is a communicating collateral. We can sacrifice this collateral, or we can ligate it or close it with a plug because we don't need it. It's communicating with the native pulmonary artery. Sometimes we may not directly be able to enter like this and demonstrate the pulmonary arteries, but we will have some telltale evidence to suggest that it is a communicating collateral. For example, in this, you can see the negative washout here. We are giving an injection into the MAPCA. You see a negative washout here. That is because it is a communicating collateral. So the blood from the native PA is washing out here. Similarly, here you can see a negative washout at the hilum. You can see the native PA partially here. So these are telltale evidences that these are communicating collaterals. So after that, we have to assess the adequacy of the pulmonary arteries. So there are various indices. So it is the institutional practice which they want to practice. So the first one, and the more commonly used for tetralogies and other conditions, is the Magoon index. The Magoon index is the diameter of the RPA plus diameter of the LPA by the diameter of the descending aorta. The RPA diameter is usually taken where the RPA crosses the lateral border of the vertebral column, and the LPA diameter is usually taken just before the branching, and the descending aortic diameter is taken just above the diaphragm. So usually more than 2 is considered normal. If it's more than 1.5, it is good for a complete repair. Even more than 1.2 is acceptable, but if it's less than 1, usually a palliative procedure is done first, a shunt, and then after it grows and the Magoon index becomes better, then a complete repair can be done. The next commonly used one is the Nakata index, or the pulmonary arterial index. Here, instead of the diameter, we take the area. So the RPA area plus LPA area by body surface area. So both we take it at pre-branching sites. So just before the branching in the RPA and LPA, divided by the body surface area. So here, more than 330 is considered normal. And if it is less than 150, usually we send for a palliative procedure first and complete repair is performed once the size improves. So both Magoon and Nakata index, both of them can be applied only when there is a unifocal source of pulmonary blood flow. If there are multiple MAPKAs associated with the pulmonary arteries, then we can't apply this Nakata index because it's not just based on the pulmonary arteries. We are going to unifocalize these MAPKAs as well. So in such cases, you have to take the total neopulmonary arterial index. So here, apart from the Nakata index, you're going to take the index of the pulmonary, the collaterals also, which you're going to unifocalize. So you decide which collaterals you are going to unifocalize, which means all the non-communicating collaterals which you are going to unifocalize. So you take the sum of all their areas, like the Nakata, you calculate for the iatropulmonary collaterals as well, and then you add it with the Nakata index. So that will give you the TNPAI or total neopulmonary arterial index. So if this is more than 200 millimeter square per meter square, then it's suitable for a complete repair. So this again is more for the proximal pulmonary arterial bed, but the distal artery session can be different. There can the distal segments already can be lost also in some cases. So for that, the another parameter which was suggested was the pulmonary segmental artery ratio, where you calculate the number of segmental arteries in each lung. You calculate bilaterally and divide it by 20. If it is more than 0.5, it is considered to be low to moderate risk. And of course, the Z-score, which all of us regularly calculate for the pulmonary arteries, but this you can't do for the MAPKAs. It is mainly for the pulmonary arteries alone. So one among the these indices can be used, or multiple ones can be used also to assess and compare to decide whether the pulmonary arterial system and the MAPKAs is it is suitable for a complete repair, or you have to go for a palliation initially. So apart from the cardiac catheterization, CT and MRI can be helpful in few of the cases. One, of course, to note the anatomy of the native PAs, especially when you are not able to demonstrate, for example, you don't have a PFO, you're not able to do a pulmonary venous wedge injection, then you may have to resort to CT to see whether native PAs are present. And the anatomy of the collaterals, especially for the course of the collaterals, if there are some complex collaterals, very tortuous ones, and you want to know with the relationship with the bronchi and the esophagus, then you may have to resort to CT, because sometimes on the cath you may not be definitively able to demonstrate. And very large collaterals, child presents late in life and you think that there is pulmonary vascular obstructive disease, then if there is a multifocal blood supply, you may not be able to calculate the PVR on the cardiac cath alone. So in such cases, you may have to resort to MRI also to know the pulmonary flows, the pressures on the cath and the flows on the MRI together, you may be able to calculate the pulmonary vascular resistance in selected cases. And one area where CT is of great help is the post-operative evaluation. So following the unifocalization surgeries, these kids will require multiple intervention procedures, or even before the complete repair surgery, you may have to you may need a more detailed evaluation of each stenosis. There'll be multiple level stenosis and all. So to know that, a CT will be very helpful, because in one go you will be able to see everything. But in a cath, you may have to give different injections in the proximal region, distal region, to see the entire pulmonary artery. So in some cases, CT will be helpful over cardiac catheterization. So after assessment, the approach to the management of pulmonary atresia, the type A, where it is only duct-dependent pulmonary circulation, here first you assess the size of the pulmonary arteries. If it's normal size confluent pulmonary arteries, then you can go for a complete repair, that is VST closure and RV2PA conduit. If they are hypoplastic, then we have to go for a palliative procedure. Based on the institutional preference, it can be either a PDA stent or a surgical iatropulmonary shunt. And then on follow-up, you again do an angiogram and reassess how the pulmonary arteries are. If they are good size, then they can go for a complete repair. If they present in the newborn period, again, it depends on the institutional practice. So some centers, they do complete repair even in the newborn period. In such cases, we can go for complete repair if they're normal size confluent PAs. However, in some centers, the complete repair is not done in the newborn period, or even at least till 3 months of age. So in such cases, in newborns, we can do a palliative procedure, and then after 6 months of age, we can do the complete repair. If there are non-confluent pulmonary arteries and bilateral pulmonary patent ductus arteriosus, in such cases, we may have to do bilateral shunts or bilateral PDA stentings and then follow it up with an interpostion graft and surgery later in life. So this is an example of a PDA stenting. So this is a vertical PDA, which is supplying the branch pulmonary arteries, and that has been stented. So in iatropulmonary shunt, there are various types of shunts. So the more commonly known one is the BT shunt. The other one is the central shunt, where you put in a shunt between the aorta and the main pulmonary artery. And the other one, which was popularized by the Melbourne group, Royal Children's Hospital, is the Melbourne shunt, where the end of the pulmonary artery is connected to the side of the aorta. So, in their subsequent articles, they had reviewed that the RPA origin stenosis and RPA thrombus was more common in this type of Melbourne shunts. And so they are not favoring it now much. So what we follow commonly is the central shunt, because this has more uniform flow to both the pulmonary arteries. So the growth of both the pulmonary arteries are better in central shunts. But that has to be done by a sternotomy, unlike a BT shunt, which can be done by a thoracotomy. So that was about type A pulmonary arteries. Yeah? In type B and C, as we already discussed, there are multiple iatropulmonary collaterals. So here the strategy of unifocalization comes in. So what do you mean by unifocalization? It is a surgical reconstruction of the pulmonary arterial tree, incorporating as many lung segments as possible by maximal recruitment of the native PAs and the MAPKA system. So you are going to recruit the native PAs and as many MAPKAs as possible so that you create one pulmonary arterial tree. That is what you mean by unifocalization. You are going to disconnect all the MAPKAs from the systemic circulation. So there are two concepts in this unifocalization. One was popularized by the Stanford group, the Frank Hanley group, and the other one from the Royal Children Melbourne group. So the Stanford school of thought is that we can do a single stage unifocalization procedure. So here they unifocalize all the MAPKAs onto the native pulmonary arteries, and based on the size, they either put in a shunt or a RBPA conduit. But it is all done in one procedure through a sternotomy. So that is the Stanford school of thought. The other school of thought is the Melbourne school of thought, where they do staged procedures. So they first do a central shunt to the native pulmonary arteries. Then they do thoracotomies. They do the left thoracotomy and unifocalize the left-sided MAPKAs. They do right thoracotomy and unifocalize the right-sided MAPKAs. And then finally, when the size improves, they do a sternotomy and do a complete repair. So that staged approach was popularized by the Melbourne school of thought. So in the single stage unifocalization, as I already told, there's a complete bilateral unifocalization through the midline sternotomy so as to create one compartment pulmonary arterial system. So the ideal age for this is early in life. Like if they present early to you, please do it within 6 months of life. So 3 to 6 months of life, we have to do a complete unifocalization, so that you prevent a progressive stenosis of this MAPKAs. And also if they are large MAPKAs, the pulmonary vascular disease also doesn't set in by then. At that stage, whether you want to put in a shunt to that unifocalized pulmonary arterial tree or whether it is RV to PA conduit, it depends on the size of the MAPKAs and size of the PA. There is one concept where if the size is not good enough, then you put in an RVPA conduit but leave on the symptoms, they approach which site to be tackled first. So a few diagrams to a few images to explain the concept of unifocalization. For example, in this image, you can see that there are native pulmonary arteries, but they are quite small. This is a communicating MAPKA. This is a non-communicating MAPKA. So we don't need the communicating MAPKA. We ligate it off or use a plug and close it off. And then the non-communicating MAPKA, we are going to unifocalize onto the native pulmonary artery. So if this size is good enough, then we directly enlarge it and put a RVPA conduit. If it is not good, then we put in a shunt for it to improve. If the native PAs are extremely small or atretic, so here you can see the LPA is only a cord, there is no lumen at all. So in such case where you can't use the native PAs at all, so you are left only with the MAPKAs to create a confluence. So here the MAPKA proximally are very small sized. So you take the hilar MAPKAs alone, you create a confluence at the right hilum and the left hilum, and then you put a long interposition graph between the right hilum and the left hilum, and then based on the size, you decide on whether it's a shunt or the RVPA conduit. But in case you have good sized large MAPKAs, to 15 lung segments have to be incorporated, and the final central PSI should be at least 50% of the normal, and you should be able to close all the septal defects. And after doing all this, if your RV pressure stays less than 2/3 of LV pressure, then you have achieved your goal. You have done a proper complete repair in that patient. So this is a rough algorithm to approach pulmonary atresia. So if you concentrate here now, so in this group, that is, you have MAPKAs, you have adequate size native pulmonary arteries, or you have MAPKAs, there are no native pulmonary arteries, but the child is asymptomatic. In that case, you can directly do unifocalization at 3 to 6 months of age. And based on the size, you can decide whether it is complete repair or a shunt to the unifocalized system. So that you can either do an intraoperative flow study, or you can judge it based on your preoperative assessment. The other group is when there are MAPKAs to one lung and a duct to another lung. So as we already discussed, duct is a precarious source of supply. We cannot wait on a duct till 3 to 6 months of life. We don't know whether it's going to close anytime. So in such case, you have to intervene in the neonatal period itself. So either it can be a complete repair, or you can put in a, if it's good sized, it can be a complete repair, or you can put in a shunt to that side where the duct is there, or you can put in a PDA stent. And for the other MAPKAs, you can approach at 3 to 6 months of life for unifocalization. The other category would be MAPKAs with severely hypoplastic native PAs. So the native PAs are so small. In that case, you can do a neonatal intervention, because you can rehabilitate those pulmonary arteries by putting in a central iatropulmonary shunt. And at 3 to 6 months of age, you'll be able to do a unifocalization, because there'll be some growth of those severely hypoplastic PAs. The other group is the symptomatic group. So if they present with severe cyanosis or overcirculation, then you may have to intervene early. You can't wait till 3 to 6 months of life. In such case, neonatal intervention is warranted based on the situation. So this is a rough algorithm to approach pulmonary atresia VST. So we saw all the surgical strategies, but what is the role of the cardiologist in this? So apart from the pre-op assessment, there is a lot of cardiac catheterization involved in these patients. Before every stage, they will need a diagnostic cardiac catheterization. Apart from that, there are several situations where we need interventions in these patients. So one such intervention already we discussed, which is the PDA stenting in the newborn period, like early in life, early infancy, when they come with a stenosed PDA and the PAs are not ready for complete repair, we will put in a PDA stenting. The other place where we do is the balloon angioplasty and stent placements following uniphoclization procedures. So you know that most of these MAPKAs are stenosed, and these MAPKAs are very tough vessels. They are muscular vessels, unlike the pulmonary arteries, which are more compliant. So they may have pre-existing stenosis, or they may those may cause stenosis after the uniphoclization also. So those have to be tackled by balloon angioplasty or stent placements before the complete repair or even after the complete repair. So here the challenge would be that you may have to access these pulmonary arteries through the shunt, because you may have to go through the central shunt or the BT shunt, or even after the conduit is placed, there may be conduit dilatation or there may be pulmonary regurgitation. So those are the challenges in approaching these pulmonary arteries, and they are not native pulmonary arterial tree. So you may have to learn the anatomy by doing a proper CT and plan your intervention prior. The other place where you would like to intervene is like when there are itopulmonary collaterals which are not needed. So in that case, we can embolize them either with a plug or a coil based on the size. Then after the complete repair is done, there can be a RVOT obstruction. In such cases, you can place in a stent, or when there's a pulmonary regurgitation, that would be an indication for a pulmonary valve placement. And very rarely, when an adult patient with multiple itopulmonary collaterals who has never been intervened in life, they present in adult life where you can't do a proper corrective surgery, you can, and they are severely cyanosed because of the stenosed MAPKAs, you can do a palliative stenting for them just to improve their saturation and quality of life. So we'll see a few examples in this category. So this is a 5-month-old child who underwent a staged uniphoclization. This child did not have any native PAs. So bilateral shunts were done to the right hilum and left hilum after uniphoclizing the respective side MAPKAs. So this here you can see that there is a critical stenosis of this, where the shunt is anastomosed to the PA and at the hilum. So you can see that the lower lobe is not filling here. That's because there is one more MAPKA which is anastomosed to this, which is not filling because of the low flow through this shunt. So this is the still image of the same. So this is after balloon dilatation. You can see that it has the stenosis is relieved and the lower lobe abrasation is now visible. This was a 10-year-old boy with the LPA stenosis following staged uniphoclization. So here you can see the LPA stenosis. Here the RV pressure was more than 2/3 of LV pressure. After stenting, it dropped to 40% of LV pressure. So we have to use redilatable stents because we have to increase the size of the stent as the child grows. This example is of a 7-year-old boy with RPA stenosis following a single stage uniphoclization and ICR. So initially the RPA stenosis was tackled with a balloon, but since it did not yield well because it was a MAPKA, so it did not yield well. So a stent was placed, though the child was smaller. So the cardiologists who had done at that time had used a renal stent, probably because that was the only one available at that time. So a renal 6 mm renal stent was used. So now the child has outgrown that stent. You can see that the RPA is smaller as compared to the LPA, and the peripheral vascularization is also less on this, paucity of arborization on the right. And you can see that there are some subtle stent fractures also seen here, because this is a renal stent. So the strategy done here was we did a slow balloon dilatation of this stent. This is not a known redilatable stent, but we thought of doing an unzipping of this stent. But we have to do this with the surgical backup and also with the presence of a covered stent as backup. So initially with an 8 mm and subsequently with a 10 mm balloon, and you can see that the struts have dilated now, and the stent is looking bigger now, and then we can put in another stent into it, and we can see that there's better arborization of the right lung. I'm sorry for that interruption, just a minute. Okay, but it is not always so, the result is not always so good. This is a long segment RPA stenosis following a staged unifocalization and intracardiac repair. This child had undergone multiple stages and now the RV, because of this RPA stenosis, the RV pressures were suprasystemic. So initially a balloon dilatation was done as the child was young. But the result was not optimal. So subsequently, a stent had to be placed, but you can see that even the stent had not dilated completely because of the tough vessel. Even on post-dilatation, the stent did not yield completely. But it did reduce the RV pressure to subsystemic, and later we had to we advised the child to go for surgery. So those were some of the examples of interventions in the subset of pulmonary atresia VSD. Now we'll see few case examples to understand the various strategies we adopt in approaching this pulmonary atresia. So this is the first case example where this is a 2.5-year-old child with a pulmonary atresia VSD and PDA supplying the branch PA. So this is a type A pulmonary atresia. Here there is bifurcation stenosis where the PDA is joining the branch pulmonary arteries, but the Magone index is good. You can see that the branch PA size is good, the peripheral arborization is good, the RPA is good sized, LPA is good sized, peripheral arborization is good sized. There are no other map casts, so the treatment is simple here. We are going to do a complete repair. So it is complete repair with the VSD closure, bifurcation plasty, and the PDA is going to be ligated. This is the second example. This is a right arch with a left ductus. This is only a 4-month-old child, but you can see that the branch PAs are very good sized. So this is a left ductus from the base of the innominate artery. This is base of the innominate artery, ductus supplying the branch pulmonary arteries. So the arborization is good. Branch PAs are good size. Magone index is good. So there are no other collaterals. Here again, we can go for a complete repair directly. So complete repair with VSD closure can be done. So this is another child where there are there is no PDA. It is all completely MAPCA dependent pulmonary circulation. But you can see the confluent pulmonary arteries. This is a 1.5-year-old child. So here you see that there are a couple of collaterals from the innominate artery. So this is a right arch with innominate artery. There is one collateral from the base of the innominate artery, which is going all the way to the hilar LPA. And there is one more, which is a tortuous collateral coming here that we will define later. So you see the native pulmonary arteries. You can see that the RPA is very good sized and the right side arborization is good. And here if you see, this is the collateral from the innominate artery, which is supplying the hilar LPA. The LPA is smaller as compared to the RPA. And one more thing I want you to see is the arborization of the LPA. So you see that it is supplying the upper lobe and part of the lower lobe, but the medial segment of this lower lobe is, it's not arborizing on the native pulmonary arterial injection. So this part of the lung, we have to define where the supply is coming from. And this MAPCA, this collateral from the innominate is a communicating collateral because you can see the native PA is getting opacified. And this is the other tortuous one which we were seeing. This is from the vertebral artery. So from the left vertebral artery, it is coming on to the confluence. This is a peculiar collateral because usually the indirect collaterals, we see them coming to the hilum of the, near the hilum. But here we see that it is coming on to the confluence and it is critically stenosed where it is attached to the confluence. So the other part of the lung is supplied by one collateral from the descending aorta. So from the descending aorta, it is supplying the medial part of the left lower lobe. So this is a non-communicating collateral. So the RPA size is good, the LPA size is borderline but still okay, and this is a non-communicating collateral. So we have to recruit this part of the lung, so we have to unifocalize this collateral onto the LPA, and since the sizes are good, we can do a complete repair here. So this is an example of a single staged unifocalization and intracardiac repair. This is a 7-year-old boy who presented with signs of heart failure. Though he was 7 years, he still had intercostal retractions. He had a saturation of 90% and he had all the signs of a heart failure. So he had large MAPCAs. So this is the angiogram which showed that the PAs are dilated, the branch pulmonary arteries are dilated. You can see the confluent branch pulmonary arteries which are dilated. Then you can see two collaterals. this is one collateral which is going to the right lung, and then the other collateral here. This is another collateral which is communicating with the hilar LPA. So this we are giving at the origin of the large communicating collateral, which is supplying the hilar LPA. So we have next entered through this collateral. We have entered through this communicating collateral and given an injection into the native pulmonary arteries. Here I would like you to notice this arborization of the right pulmonary artery. You can see that the RPA is arborizing to the upper lobe and the lower lobe, but a part of the middle lobe arborization is not seen on the native pulmonary artery injection. So you can see that this part is not supplied by the native pulmonary artery. So, but if you see the other collateral which was supplying the right lung, that is the one which is supplying that part of the right lung. So this MAPKA has to be unifocalized because you want to recruit this part of the lung also. So, but the problem in this patient is the pulmonary artery pressure. You can see that the PAs are dilated. There is obviously PAH. So the PA pressure is near systemic. It is iota was 97 and PA is 80. So whether we can do a complete repair or not in this patient is a question. So, but in this child, clinically, there were all signs of increased pulmonary blood flow. For example, I will show you the X-ray. You can see that there are signs of increased pulmonary blood flow on the X-ray also. You can see the multiple end-on views and there are no signs of proning on this X-ray. So, and clinically also there were signs of increased pulmonary blood flow. LV was dilated on the echo. So since we know that it was an increased blood flow in this situation, we expected that this is going to be a reversible PAH. So what we did was we unifocalized this right MAPKA onto the RPA, and then we put a band over this communicating MAPKA. So after a week of the surgery, then again we did an assessment on the catheterization. So here now we have entered through the banded MAPKA and giving an injection. Now you note the arborization. You can see that the right, the middle lobe is also filling because that MAPKA has been unifocalized onto the RPA now. So this is the MAPKA. This is the unifocalized MAPKA here, this one. So this is the banded MAPKA. So now since it is only one focus of supply now only one MAPKA is supplying the entire pulmonary arterial tree, we'll be able to calculate the PVRI on the cath itself. So you can see that the PA pressure has dropped to 35 from 80 and the PVRI is 4.5, which is acceptable for a biventricular repair. So this child underwent a complete biventricular repair. And but since here we were very sure based on the clinical situation that this PAH is reversible, we did the reassessment within a week of the banding. But in conditions where it is borderline, you can band it and you can wait for 6 months or 1 year and repeat the cardiac catheterization and then decide about the complete repair. Now, this is a one-year-old child who had undergone central shunt for hypoplastic PAs in early infancy. You can see this is an injection through the central shunt. The RPA, the proximal RPA is small. The hilar RPA and LPA seem to be okay. And concentrate on the arborization of this left side. So you can see that the LPA is supplying the upper lobe and part of the lower lobe. So this part of the lobe is not being supplied by that. So if you see the other MAPKAs, there is one good sized MAPKA to the right lung. And there's one more MAPKA from the descending aorta, which is supplying this part of the lung, which was not supplied by the native pulmonary artery. So you have to unifocalize both these MAPKAs. So both these MAPKAs were unifocalized onto this native pulmonary arteries. And initially the right side by right thoracotomy, and then the left, because this is a stenosed MAPKA, you have to take it right at the hilum. It was done through a thoracotomy. So staged right and left unifocalizations were done. And this is, after that, a complete repair could be achieved. This is following the complete repair. You can see that the pulmonary arteries look good. And we have an angiogram after 3 years of follow-up. So you can see that the pulmonary arteries are good sized. So this is an example of staged unifocalization, and a complete repair could be achieved. There is some pulmonary regurg you can see, but that can be followed up. So this case is an example of a non-confluent pulmonary arteries. This is a six-month-old child with pulmonary atresia and non-confluent pulmonary arteries. So I will freeze this first angio. You can see that there is a right ductus which is supplying the right lung. And on the pulmonary venous wedge angio, you can see that there is a hilar LPA. But beyond that, you can't see the LPA. So beyond that, it is atretic. Only the, till the hilum, the LPA was present. And you can see that there is a small stump at the innominate artery base. So this was the left ductus which was supplying this LPA, but now that has become atretic. So they are non-confluent branch pulmonary arteries present only at the hilum. There are no central pulmonary arteries. So here what we do is we put in a shunt to this left pulmonary artery. You have to put in a shunt or stent this PDA to the right pulmonary artery. So we did bilateral shunts. So this is the left shunt to the LPA and this is the right shunt to the RPA. After giving some time for the pulmonary arteries to grow at the hilum, a long interposition graft was put after a few months. A long interposition graft was put from this hilum to that hilum, from the right to the left hilum. So I will freeze here to show you the interposition graft. So this is the interposition graft. From this hilum to this hilum, a long interposition graft has been put. So initially it was not, the hilar PAs were not that well developed. In fact, the left pulmonary artery required some balloon dilatation also in between the stages. So in this patient, the VSG was left open initially, only the RV2PA conduit was put. Then subsequently, when the PAs had grown well and the peripheral arterization was very good, then a complete repair was done by closing of that VSD. So this was the final complete pulmonary arterial tree achieved in this patient who had a non-confluent PAs. So this this is another case where this is a three-year-old child who presented very symptomatic, very cyanosed and polycythemic. So you can see that not many collaterals, only one collateral you can see in this. So you can just see one collateral coming from the base of the left carotid coming all the way down. Apart from that, there are no major collaterals. So this is the collateral injection you can see. So that is the injection into the collateral. Especially the right one, right branch is well developed. The left branch is very small of this collateral. So we have to define whether native PAs are present. So this is the pulmonary venous wedge injection. So if you see here, very faintly thread-like native PAs could be seen. This seagull appearance is seen. Extremely hypoplastic. You can see only around 1 to 2 mm native PAs. So this is the native PA. But this child doesn't have any major collaterals. So you have to rehabilitate this pulmonary artery, however hypoplastic they seem to be. We have to try to rehabilitate that. So what we did is first put in a central shunt to this native pulmonary arteries. Then that one collateral which had a good branch to the right lung, that was unifocalized on to the hilar RPA, and another shunt, a BT shunt, was put on to that hilar RPA. So this is after 15 days of that shunt, we did an angiogram just to see whether it has opened up, because they were so small, so severely hypoplastic native PAs. We wanted to know whether the shunt is functioning well. And so in 15 days itself, you can see that the branch PAs are this size, which means that the native PAs were extremely underfilled at that time. That's why they were looking so hypoplastic. So this case I showed to impress upon you that you have to respect whatever size the native PAs may be. You have to respect them and try to rehabilitate them. You have to recruit them in your pulmonary arterial tree. So especially if they are younger, especially in infancy, however small the native PAs may be, you have to put in a shunt and try to rehabilitate the native PAs, and they have a great potential to grow. So this one really amazed us, because in just 15 days, we can see that what were seen like thread-like pulmonary arteries, you can see this much flow into the pulmonary arteries now. And the right side also, we had put in a BT shunt because we had unifocalized MAPKA there. So here, the flow is not good because of the competitive flow from the BT shunt here. So after waiting for 1 year, we could see that the native PAs have grown to some extent. So these are the native PAs after 1 year. But still, they are not good enough to complete the repair. So what we did is we only did, this was a valvar pulmonary atresia. We have done a pulmonary valvotomy. Instead of putting a conduit, we have done a pulmonary valvotomy and left the VSD open. So this child is waiting to for the next stage surgery. But this case, I really wanted to show to tell you the important fact that always look for native pulmonary arteries. Find out even if they are very hypoplastic, we have to recruit them. So this is the final case. So this was an adult with extreme cyanosis and polycythemia. She did not have any central pulmonary arteries. So they were only at the hilum. So in this patient, to do a complete, to do a corrective surgery would be very difficult. So we have to concentrate more on the palliation of this patient only. So either we can, this is actually a MAPCA from the left MAPCA from the innominate artery, which is supplying the hilar LPA. So either we can do a stenting here, or we can do a shunt. In this patient, we did a shunt, a central shunt from the ascending aorta to the hilar LPA. So this was the shunt which was done. So we can do palliative procedures also for adults. So we can consider either a stenting of the MAPCA or palliative shunts. So the take-home message here would be that first is early and detailed assessment of the anatomy of the pulmonary blood supply. So even if they are asymptomatic, even if you think that it's a balanced circulation, you have to assess them early. You have to do a diagnostic catheterization or a CT angiogram, and you have to assess them early in life before 3 months of age, and achieve early unifocalization within 6 months of age so that you can prevent progressive stenosis of these collaterals and also prevent pulmonary vascular obstructive disease. Surgical strategies differ based on the institutions, and they are still evolving. In the last two decades, there has been a great development and progress in this field, but still surgical strategies are still evolving. And most of them require frequent transcatheter PA rehabilitation in between the stages. So it is a teamwork ultimately in this group. So thank you very much. And this lady underwent staged unifocalization in disconnected PAs, non-confluent PAs. And finally, we could achieve a good complete repair in her to the extent that RV pressure was very good. And she could undergo an uneventful pregnancy. And this was a healthy child which she delivered a couple of years ago. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sailila. It's really wonderful, and a lot of cases really enjoyable. I think a lot of work, staged unifocalization, complete, non-confluent, hypoplastic. I am very much impressed with that last but one case, very tiny PAs. I think most of the times, as you said, that underfilled, all those things. Very nice. And students, if there are any questions, either you can directly communicate Dr. Sailila or you can put it in the group. So thank you very much. Then I will end the session then.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.